again, we thank him for coming all this distance to participate on the panel.
Thank you to everybody who's in attendance, and welcome to the College of Law. I see some familiar faces and some I don't recognize yet, so I'm very glad to have everybody here to talk about a very, very important issue about how can we get dark money out of politics. Now, that's the heart of the topic here today. I have the pleasure, I guess, or not so much pleasure, of setting the problem up. I'm going to spend about 10 or 15 minutes explaining how we got to the situation we're in, what the problem is, the nature of the problem. And then Jeff, who's been working on this for a lot longer than I have, will tell us how we can get engaged to help change the story and make things different. It turns out that we have some tools here in Wyoming to get this done. And I think there's a very good opportunity for us here to actually make a big difference and get a 28th Amendment to the Constitution adopted. And Wyoming is part of the process. When states call for constitutional amendments, if enough states do that, then Congress has to act, and we are a state. So we have an opportunity to add our voice to the 18 states that have already done this. We want to be the 19th state, and maybe others joining us as well as we go forward in the next few years. So I'm going to start off with a couple of readings, short readings, political readings from politicians, and then start and talk a little bit about how we got into the mess that we are in right now. So first reading is this. It has been thought that government is a compact between those who govern and those who are governed. But this cannot be true, because it is putting the effect before the cause. For as man must have existed before governments existed, there necessarily was a time when governments did not exist, and consequently, there could originally exist no governors to form such a compact with. The fact, therefore, must be that the individuals themselves, each in his own personal and sovereign right, entered into a compact with each other to produce a government. And this is the only mode in which governments have a right to arise and the only principle on which they have a right to exist. That's Thomas Paine, Rights of Man, 1791. Second reading is a little shorter. I hope we shall crush in its birth the aristocracy of our moneyed corporations, which dare already to challenge our government to a trial by strength and bid defiance to the laws of our country. Anybody know that quote? Anybody? Yeah. Thomas Jefferson, 1816. Thomas Jefferson was no friend of corporations. And I begin this discussion today with these two historical quotes, mostly to remind us that this country has not always been a corporatocracy. It's not baked into our system of government. At the founding of the country, corporations were viewed with great skepticism. In fact, when you think about it, the very first battle of the American Revolution, even before the Declaration of Independence, was a revolt not against the British Crown directly, it was against a corporation. The British East India Company, which had received special privileges in tea trade, it got those privileges from the Crown, but the Boston Tea Party consisted of a revolt against that corporation. Even a century later, the good citizens recognized that corporations in this country are creatures of the state and therefore subject to state regulation and control. In 1889, the citizens of the state of Wyoming, including women voters, to our great credit, for the first time in American history, women voters were allowed to vote. We adopted our Constitution in 1889. Article 10, Section 2 of that Constitution reads, quote, "All powers and franchises of corporations are derived from the people and are granted by their agent, the government, for the public good and general welfare, and the right and duty of the state to control and regulate them for these purposes is hereby declared. So the 1889 Constitution makes a clear distinction between corporations and people. People have the right to control and regulate corporations through their agent, the government. Other parts of the Wyoming Constitution are pretty clear as well, that the rights guaranteed under that document are to be enjoyed by human beings, not artificial beings. Article 1, Section 2 of the Wyoming Constitution, adopted in 1889, as I said, reads, "In their inherent right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, all members of the human race are equal." The use of the words human race is telling. Corporations need not apply for equality. So in Wyoming, we have a very strong foundation for corporations are not people, they are subject to our control, and this effort to amend the Constitution is fully embraced by the Wyoming Constitution. However, in the legal context, a series of court decisions have held that corporations do indeed have the same rights as human persons, at least in terms of the Bill of Rights, freedom of speech, things like that. The poster child, and there's been a series of cases, been an incremental step forward from baby steps towards the more recent decisions that embrace pretty much full equality for corporate speech in political contexts. The poster child for this problem is the 2010 case, Citizens United versus Federal Elections Commission, probably one of the most ironically named cases in American constitutional law, because the case says Citizens United, it's not really a case in which the citizens are trying to claim rights. The case actually stands for the fact that corporations have rights, not so much normal people like you and me. Let me just step aside. We're in a law school setting, so I have the freedom to, and I'm a law professor, so, and I have the podium. So I'm going to tell a little story, a little legal history story that's interesting. It's kind of the start of how we got to where we are, that start is a case called Santa Clara County versus Southern Pacific Railroad, 1886, just 3 years before we adopted our Constitution. In that case, and this case is generally cited and referred to as the case that started the process of giving corporations the rights of human beings. The issue in that case involved whether Santa Clara County in California could legally tax fences along the Southern Pacific Railroad lines that ran through the county. So it's about taxing fences, that's all it is. The railroad raised a number of defenses, four or five defenses. First one was that the railroad was authorized by the US government and you can't tax the government. The second one is the one that's relevant to our point. The second defense they raised was that this tax violates the 14th Amendment. At that point, only less than 20 years old, but the 14th Amendment, which guarantees equal protection to all persons, the railroad claimed that the way fences were taxed differed, the railroad fences were being taxed in a different way than fences owned by human beings. They were not allowed to deduct mortgage debt from their taxation, whereas human beings could. That was unfair to them, and therefore they are entitled to equal protection and have their fences taxed in exactly the same way as human being fences owned by human beings. Third defense was that California state law was not properly enacted. Fourth defense was assessment wasn't properly processed by California state people. There was some confusion about what the assessment meant. Those are the four defenses that were raised. And the court did what courts are supposed to do. The court decided the case on the narrowest possible ground. The narrowest possible ground was that last one. There was some mix-up and some confusion about what was being assessed, and because the assessment, you couldn't tell what was fence and what was other stuff. They said the whole thing makes no sense. We throw the entire assessment out. Railroad wins. The court did not reach the equal protection claim, the claim that corporations have the same rights as humans. That was explicitly turned out. The court explicitly said, we're not going to get there. As the judgment can be sustained upon the California state law, it is not necessary to consider any other questions raised by the pleadings. So the court did not reach the issue of whether corporations have the same rights as people. So how did this case come to stand for the proposition that corporations are people too? There is some language, if you pick up the book, the right book off the shelf in the library, you can find something called a syllabus. For those of you who are lawyers, you know what that is. If you're not a lawyer, the syllabus is something written by a court reporter, a person, not a judge. It's kind of a summary of the issue, summary of the case, and it's published with the opinion to help the reader understand what's going to happen next, but it's not part of the opinion. That syllabus, written by a court reporter, contains this language. One of the points made and discussed at length in the brief of counsel was that corporations are persons within the meaning of the 14th Amendment. Before argument, Mr. Chief Justice Waite said, quote, the court does not wish to hear argument on the question whether the provision of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution, which forbids a state to deny any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws, applies to these corporations. We are of the opinion that it does. So the syllabus basically says, we're going to assume for the purpose of this argument that corporations are people. Don't argue this, counsel. We want to hear about the rest of these other issues. So in a nutshell, the case involves whether the county can tax a fence. One of the defenses raised was that they were being treated unfairly and that humans had more rights to lower assessments than the railroad did. The parties briefed that, but the court said, don't argue that, don't worry about it. We don't want to hear argument about that. And then the court decided on narrow grounds and did not reach that issue. But yet the case stands for the proposition that corporations are people because of that syllabus. What's interesting is that the case did not quote a prior case, did not cite a prior case. This very question about whether corporations have the same rights as people under the 14th Amendment was litigated in the Supreme Court in 1871, just 3 years after the enactment of the 14th Amendment. In Insurance Company versus New Orleans, the court, and I'm going to read another quote, the plain and evident meaning of the section of the 14th Amendment is that persons to whom the equal protection of the law is secured are persons born or naturalized or endowed with life and liberty, and consequently natural and not artificial persons. Very explicit. The question about whether the 14th Amendment word persons covers corporation, 3 years after that word was put into the Constitution, they said, no, we don't mean artificial corporations. That case was not cited in Santa Clara County, nor has it been cited in any of the recent cases that do give corporations that right. So later cases do, of course, give corporations the rights of human beings. So what difference does it make that we have this old case that nobody cites anymore? It doesn't matter. The more recent cases do stand for that proposition clearly, but I want to raise this briefly. If you are a Supreme Court justice who favors an originalist interpretation of texts, one of the evidence you look for is what were the contemporaneous writings, how did they interpret it originally when it was fresh, and the people who understood what was intended, what did they say about it? 3 years after the 14th Amendment was adopted, The Supreme Court says this does not apply to corporations. Originalists should say corporations are not people. Yet here we are with a wealth of more modern cases that do hold, in fact, corporations are people too. So there are, the problem we have here is that corporate personhood is based, dark money in politics has two basic metaphors that it relies on. Number one, corporations are people, and two, money is speech. Those are metaphors that I think are problematic, and I think have paralyzed judicial thinking to the point where we have this problem of significant public money or private money in politics. The problem is not, it's bipartisan. Both Democrats, Republicans, everybody who runs for high office gets contributions, and the money corrupts the process. The most recent example, of course, was just last week when Senator Cory Booker, who was a darling of the Democratic Party, voted to bar import of Canadian drugs to America. Canadian drugs are far cheaper, sometimes a third the cost of American. They're the same drugs, but if you import them from Canada, you pay a different price and you can get a huge savings. Senator Booker's stated rationale was that any plan to import drugs from Canada should, quote, also include consumer protections that ensure foreign protections that ensure foreign drugs meet American safety standards. That's the stated rationale. But really? Really? It soon came out that he, of all the Democratic senators who voted against this measure, he had received more in contributions from the big pharmaceutical companies, employees, people affiliated with Big Pharma, had given him $267,000 for his last campaign. So you do the math. Was he really looking out for the consumers, or was he looking out for his donors? The idea that corporations are people may seem silly to non-lawyers, but to a lawyer, it's not really that unusual a concept. It's what lawyers call a legal fiction, essentially an abstract workaround to enable the court to reason by analogy or reach some decision that makes sense. It assumes that something that is clearly not true is true for the limited purpose of reaching some logical decision in a case. An example might be an adoptive birth certificate. So if you adopt a child, and a child who was born in Wyoming is adopted here or anywhere, they get a new birth certificate by state law, and this is probably true in other states as well. The child, the state of Wyoming will issue a new birth certificate with the correct day and date and time of birth, the correct county of birth, but now listing the adoptive parents as the parents on the birth certificate, replacing the original birth certificate. Now, the adoptive parents know that they weren't in the delivery room on that time and place and date when the child was born, and the court knows that too, but we're going to give a birth certificate out to say that is true. It's a legal fiction. It serves a very good purpose. It allows the child to have documentation of their birth that's accurate as to the time and place, and therefore it's a legal fiction that we solve a problem with. But a legal fiction should actually operate only for the purpose for which it was created and should not be extended beyond its legitimate field. Nor should it be extended so as to create unjust results. It should only be used as a workaround to achieve a legally satisfying result to get around some unusual obstacle. The problem with the corporations are people metaphor is that this legal fiction or analogy has been taken way too far. It no longer serves just as a workaround to solve a specific legal problem. Instead, it has been taken to endow rights onto corporations, even the same rights that non-humans have. This corporations are people metaphor is no longer just a legal fiction, it's more of a magic wand. Bing, you now have the right to political speech. Bing, you have other rights that there was no problem until we gave these rights away. But this is crazy, isn't it? corporations are not humans. They are very different kinds of entities. If they're humans, they're superhumans, right? They don't ever die. They feel no pain. They have no emotions. They don't require clean air and clean water and a good environment the way human beings do. Another way to think of them might be as a super predator. Corporations want to get raw materials at the cheapest possible cost. They want to force others, you and me, to bear the cost of cleaning up the messes that they make, because if they can export the cost of cleanup, they can sell their products cheaper and make more money. So that's their incentive. They also want labor at the cheapest possible price. And this is not some bug in this. This is a feature. Corporations have an obligation to their shareholders to maximize value. And this is one way they do it. If they can pay labor less, they can sell for a higher profit and maximize value for their shareholders. That's what they're supposed to do. So thus, corporations are not just not serving people, they're actually starting to oppress people. Remember, we created corporations to serve us, not the other way around. We didn't want them to exploit us, take advantage of us, and make more money on our backs. So the corporation and metaphor problem is a metaphor that the Supreme Court can't seem to reason its way out of. It's a legal fiction that has gone way beyond its purpose of serving justice and is being used now to create injustice. So why don't we just simply enforce the Wyoming Constitution? It says that we have the right to control. The problem is that we have a thing called the Supremacy Clause. Article 6, Section 2 of the U.S. Constitution says the U.S. Constitution is the supreme law of the land, and all state laws, including state constitutions, that's explicit, are subservient and trumped by the Supremacy Clause. So we need to solve this problem at a national level. The simple solution is to recognize that these twin metaphors need to be replaced by more useful ones. So corporations are not people, they're tools. Better metaphor. Money is not speech, it's a megaphone. It allows somebody who has his message to broadcast it more broadly and drown out the voice of people. The corporation, our tools metaphor, works better because corporations do have specific limited uses. They're useful in certain contexts. So I want to be clear here that I am not I'm not here to say that corporations are bad. They're not. They are useful. Corporations have a very specific use to help us order our economic activity. For that purpose, we created them for that purpose. They serve that purpose well. They should continue to serve that purpose going forward. And I'm not even against allowing corporations some free speech rights. Corporations, in order to advance their economic interests, should have the right to advertise their products and have economic kinds of speech that is useful to their purposes. That's fine. But commercial speech is fundamentally different from other types of non-commercial speech or political speech. We and the courts recognize this, right? First Amendment law puts certain restrictions, allows for significant restrictions on commercial speech. We have truth in advertising laws. We can compel speech by requiring warnings and labels on products. So commercial speech is subject to much more significant restriction than non-political speech. It's the political speech that I think is that we need to be concerned about. So let's not lose sight of the prize here. The goal is not to destroy corporations. The goal is to enact meaningful campaign finance reform. Remember, the Citizens United was a campaign finance case. It invalidated sections of the McCain-Feingold bipartisan campaign finance law. So in order to the Citizens United case was based on an interpretation of the Constitution, the Congress cannot just enact a new law. You have to change the Constitution so that the court no longer can say that corporations have the same rights as human beings. So That's the problem that we've got. I've taken more of the time than I should have. Jeff Clements from American Promise is here to help us do the happier part of the talk is how do we fix this? And there are ways we can fix this, and Jeff will help us out with that.
Thank you, Ken. Professor Chestek, thanks so much. And thanks to all of you for being here as part of this conversation today. I am from Concord, Massachusetts. Nice to see your Red Sox hat out there, sir. And in Concord is where you may remember the American Revolution began, at the North Bridge, just a mile or so from where my wife and I live. And that is where we got the name for American Promise. At that day when farmers and people in town and everyone else said, enough is enough. We have to stand up to the most powerful empire that ever existed up to that time, the British Empire, that was oppressing the people, that was taking away what were viewed as inherent natural rights of human beings. Enough was enough, and at least in Concord, we say the revolution began that day at North Bridge at the battle that sent the British back to Boston. And that day was reflected in the Declaration of Independence less than a year later, a little bit over a year later. We take these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. The good people of Wyoming corrected that and said all men and women are created equal. And I love your motto here in Wyoming of equal rights and known as the equality state. All of that is part of the American promise. The promise is this radical idea, right? That human beings are born equal, we're going to be equal, we're going to govern ourselves together. And that wasn't true then at the North Bridge. It wasn't true when we fought the Civil War. It's not yet true today, but that is what drives Americans, I believe. No matter what your politics, in our hearts we actually believe that promise, and we're determined to make it true generation after generation. So why are we here today? Why do we need a 28th Amendment to fulfill this promise? Well, the reason is, as Professor Chestek laid out, the Supreme Court has made a series of decisions that have flipped the promise upside down. Citizens United struck down the Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act. That's what the decision did. Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission struck down the Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act under a theory, as Professor Chestek said, that corporations have the same rights as people, and since money is speech, corporate money is also speech, so corporations, unions, the super wealthy, doesn't matter. If they want to spend unlimited money in our elections to influence our elections, we, the people, are not allowed to do anything about it. So the Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act was ruled unconstitutional. About a year or two later, they struck down the Montana Corrupt Practices Act. I think Wyoming and many other states, including Massachusetts, had similar laws going back to the early 1900s when we were wrestling with similar problems we are today of concentrated wealth and power overwhelming the rights and the hopes of we the people governing ourselves. And corrupt practices acts were passed to say corporations stay in the economic field, that's great, but you can't spend money to influence our elections because it takes away the right, those equal rights that are in the Wyoming Constitution and in our federal constitution. Unlimited corporate money, unlimited billionaire money, unlimited union money, doesn't matter where the source is, if unlimited money is influencing elections and driving our public policy rather than debate among we the people, we have exactly what the founders of the Constitution worried about most. They were obsessed with systemic corruption, with concentrated powers, with forces that would basically make the rights of individual human beings impossible to stand against. They're too strong, whether it's big government or big money. And so that's why we're here today, because the Supreme Court is taking us down a road that if we don't change, we will have what the founders worried about, oligarchy or plutocracy, basically government of the money, government of the powerful, not government of the people. So that's why we formed American Promise. It is to win the 28th Amendment. It'll be the eighth time the American people have come together across all partisan lines, because you have to win amendments. You can't do it 51-49. You need a national consensus to do it. But it'll be the eighth time we do it to overturn Supreme Court decisions. This is not the first time. We've been here before. The Supreme Court said African Americans can't be citizens, literally. Supreme Court said women have no right to vote. Supreme Court said a poll tax that kept people without economic means from voting is okay. lots of other decisions we've had to overturn to get back towards that American promise. And that's what we're going to do together. I'm going to ask you at the end of this to join us and get some things going right here in Wyoming that will be part of what we're calling the National Citizens Uprising. An uprising sounds like pitchforks and everything, but don't forget that first word, citizens. Citizenship is responsible, it's determined, it's doing the right thing for the public good and for each other. So this is a peaceful revolution, but it is a revolution indeed because we have to flip back that concentration of power, those rights of the powerful against the rights of the people, and get back on track to the American promise. So let me very briefly, before I do this, I'll come back to how we're going to win this 28th Amendment, where we are right now in the fight, and what we can do right here in Wyoming. But first, I'm so honored to share with you a greeting and words from the nation's statesmen and one of your former senators, Alan Simpson, who could not be with us today. He wanted to be. He's on our advisory council at American Promise. We bring Democrats, Independents, Republicans together to do this work. And he proudly stood up, as we're asking everyone in America to do, stand up and stand with other people, even if they don't agree with you. So Republicans and Democrats standing together, and Senator Simpson was one of the first to say, count me in. And so he sends the following, it's on the table out on your way out. Feel free to take it with you. In fact, take two and share it with others who might want to know more about this. He says, from Senator Simpson, dear fellow citizens of Wyoming, I so wish I could be back in Laramie with you today, and I want to thank you for joining this urgent conversation regarding our democracy. While my travel obligations prevent me from joining you in person, I am fully committed to working with you and with Americans across our country to pass a 28th Amendment to our Constitution so that people, not money, corporations, unions, or special interests, but we the people, govern America. I serve on the cross-partisan National Advisory Council of American Promise and hope that you might join the work of American Promise to sound the alarm and rally our nation to secure our constitutional foundation before it's too late. Money's dominance over politics is the number one problem our nation faces. And Senator Simpson, again, money's dominance over politics is the number one problem our nation faces. It is a growing crisis that prevents us from tackling anything else. We've now reached a turning point. Either we are a country that makes decisions based on the common good, or one where the size of your wallet determines the worth of your ideas. Either we uphold the values of representative democracy, or we allow greed and wealth to destroy the great American experiment in self-governance. The 28th Amendment allows us to make this choice. We need a constitutional amendment because the Supreme Court, in cases such as Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission, has made a series of dangerously wrong decisions that make effective reform virtually impossible without a constitutional amendment. The Supreme Court is wrong. No one has the right to drown out the freedom of others to speak or to deny the rights of all Americans by corrupting our political process. And no corporation can take over the fundamental inherent rights of human beings. Senator Simpson continues, we know this in Wyoming. Our state constitution declares it is the inherent right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness that all members of the human race are equal. Unlike the Supreme Court, we do not get confused about differences between human beings and corporations. Our Wyoming constitution states, corporations being creatures of the state endowed for the public good with a portion of its sovereign powers must be subject to its control. In our Wyoming constitution, we insist on the truth of our political equality. That is not the equality of material goods or luck, but the simple American equality where having a lot of money does not give anyone more political rights than anybody else. And what right and privilege could be more important than one person, one vote, being able to stand up as an equal citizen to have your say in our political system, knowing that the political game is not rigged to favor concentrated wealth? We need to get back to basics with our Constitution and our political system. As a nation, we cannot accept the law of aristocracy, where the political rights of people are based on their wealth. I urge you to support a 28th Amendment to the Constitution so we can have reasonable limits on election spending, reform pay-to-play politics, and secure human liberty and equal representation rather than turn our government over to a global corporate marketplace. We can and we should put Wyoming firmly on the right side of the fight for the future of our democracy. I'm delighted that my alma mater, the University of Wyoming, is hosting this conversation, and I look forward to working closely with you to bring the people of Wyoming and the country together to win a 28th Amendment and restore our American promise of human liberty, equal citizenship, and responsible self-government. Respectfully and sincerely, Alan K. Simpson. So, we wish he could be with us today, but we're so glad to have his support and encouragement in this fight. So how are we going to win the 28th Amendment? Well, under Article 5 of the Constitution, we need to have two-thirds of Congress pass an amendment out to the, that then goes out to the states, and it's ratified by three-quarters of the states. Alternatively, in Article 5, there's a provision that allows two-thirds of the states to basically instruct Congress to call a constitutional convention to propose the amendment, and again, it then goes to the states for ratification. Either way, the amendment comes either Congress or convention is then ratified by 38 states. That's three-quarters of the states. We haven't had a convention since the Philadelphia Convention in 1787, but this method has been used to pressure Congress to get the amendment out. And my friend Shelby from Wolfpack is here today and can tell you more about the call for a convention path that Wolfpack is working on, and we're happy to talk about all of this and some questions and answers in a moment. But either way, we need to bring Americans together, because none of these things are going to happen without a whole lot of work by us and a whole lot of pressure that we must get this done. And so how can we do it? If it feels like the country is divided, right? It feels like, you know, we don't have power as people anymore. The system feels out of control. How are we going to do this? Well, the great untold story of America in 2016 is this 28th Amendment movement. Over and over again, we've demonstrated Americans actually aren't divided on this. We stand together on this, and we're getting stronger and stronger and stronger. 18 states have now called formally for this 28th Amendment to get money out of politics. Four of those states did it by ballot initiative. Your neighbor Montana did it, along with Colorado, your other neighbor, in 2012, passing a 28th Amendment resolution on the ballot, 75% to 25%. That was Republicans, Democrats, Independents voting to do that. Two more states, Washington and California, passed ballot initiatives in November 2016, just this past election. And then a little-known story out of Wisconsin, 18 towns and cities passed ballot initiatives calling for the 28th Amendment. Now that brings to about 750 cities and towns in America that have passed resolutions for this 28th Amendment. Another untold story in the media. You wouldn't know that nearly 1,000 communities have had meetings and done ballot initiatives and done things to express the will of the American people that we want our Constitution fixed so we the people can govern instead of money. Well, those 18 states in Wisconsin, the reason I highlight them is the lowest passage of one of those resolutions, one town, did it by 65%. That was the lowest out of those 18. One did it by 91% approval, and everyone else was in between. So remember, Wisconsin voted, would be called under the conventional wisdom, so-called, of our political analysis, a red state. I think those terms aren't useful anymore, but say Wisconsin's a red state. This is a red state voting 91% in just one town, and you know, somewhere around 75%, just like Montana and Colorado, for this amendment. Janesville, Wisconsin's the hometown of the House Speaker, Paul Ryan. They passed it 84% in favor. This is something Americans want. Doesn't matter, Republican, Democrat, Independent. That is a huge head start on winning a constitutional amendment, because you have to have national consensus. Well, guess what? We have national consensus. Americans want this. So what do we do next? Well, we're doing what we call the citizen uprising, as I said, the national citizen uprising. And the idea is we want to offer every American can do something. You no longer have to just say, well, gee, I wish we could do something about money in politics or overwhelming corporate power or my feeling like I have no rights to stand up as a citizen and be an equal in this system anymore. Well, now you can. We will offer on the way out, check out, I want to be part of the Citizen Uprising. And there's boxes with lots of different ways you can be part of. You can do it as easily as signing up at American Promise to stay in touch. Or you can go deeper and do something we call the Citizen Uprising Core Team. And that will get you on conference calls about twice a month with people all over the country who are doing this work. It's all volunteer. I'm a volunteer. It's all, again, Americans working in their communities, but connecting together. That's how we accelerate the work. So you can do it locally, and you can be connected to this great national movement. And Wyoming, as Professor Chestek said, is one of the states that allow ballot initiatives. It's one of the states that has not yet joined this, the 18 other states. You could join Colorado and Montana and make a great mountain state stand together for the 28th Amendment. And you could do it in one of two ways. You can have your legislature pass a resolution. That's what we did in Massachusetts. Our legislature did it. Or you can do a ballot initiative and let all the people of Wyoming have their say. And neither of those will just happen. They will happen because you decide you want it to happen. And you join other Wyoming people to make it happen. That's what the uprising is all about. People are doing it all over the country. We're going next to the Washington State. I'll be in Auburn, Washington, the hometown of Congressman Dave Reichert. Every single county in his congressional district voted for the 28th Amendment in November. And so we're going to invite him to join and become a champion of this. He hasn't yet signed on to the amendment. But this idea is everywhere. You can either work to get your congresspeople on board, you can get your state on board, you can write letters to the editor, you can simply support it financially, and there's a way to do that as well on the forum. We hope you will, because I guarantee you this is not going to be top-down, corporate-funded, big donor-driven. This is going to be the people deciding we want to do it and pitching in some money to help. So there's lots of ways to do it. And so where we go from here, if you like this idea, if you like the idea of fixing this once and for all with the 28th Amendment that lets us get money out of politics, that lets us get people back in to politics, that heals the divides in this country, that proves once and for all, as something I know and I'm absolutely positive, great faith in the American people's determination to hold to that American promise and to make it count. It doesn't mean you have faith in parties or politics or all of the things that can let us down. We have faith in each other that we can be a generation just like previous generations that take us that one step further to fulfilling the American promise. So I hope you'll join the uprising, take the form, fill out how you want to be part of it, and let's do this together and do this across Wyoming and across the United States. Thank you very much.
We have some time for some questions and answers, but before we do that, I want to point out one more thing about how we are actually taking action right now. Excuse me. I was hoping to be able to announce at this session or one of the sessions today that we have a resolution that has been introduced in the state legislature to do this. We're this close. Not quite introduced yet, but I've been meeting with numerous legislators in Cheyenne and pitching this to them, and I have a commitment from a legislator who shall be named later when the bill finally gets dropped into the process. I want that legislator to be able to make the announcement, the official announcement, but we're very close to having a resolution to do this introduced in the Wyoming legislature. And we're in the process of recruiting more co-sponsors, and we want this to be bipartisan. I've talked with some Republicans who might be co-sponsors. And one thing that you can do right now, today, contact your legislator, say you are in support of the 20th Amendment, this is coming through the legislature right now, get on board, please be a co-sponsor for this, and just talk to your legislator, whoever that is, and try and get them on board. The more pressure we can put on, the more likely it is we'll get it introduced. Now, having said that, introducing it is one thing, adopting it, passing is another thing. The people, I think the chances of it actually passing the legislature are greater than zero, but less than 50% probably. So the chances of it actually getting out of the legislature with an affirmative vote are probably less than half. So if it fails in the legislature, plan B is we have the initiative process. We, the people, say, all right, legislature, you had your opportunity to do this. You didn't. Now we're taking over, and we're going to do it by ballot initiative. And we, so this summer, if we don't get it through the legislature by the end of February, we're going to start handing out clipboards and say, go get some signatures and let's get it on the ballot. It's going to be a statewide effort, and Wolfpack's going to be helping us with that. There's a movement building to get this done by ballot initiative if we have to, because that's how it was done in Colorado and Montana with great success. So we are trying our best to get this moving forward. So with that, Jeff and I are both willing to answer any questions. We are taping this to put on YouTube, so that's why we're both mic'd. So when you speak, speak loudly, and I will come stand next to you so you can hear, so my mic will pick you up. So question in the back here for either one of us.
Yes, you have spoken very logically and convincingly. What happened 8-9 years ago at the Supreme Court? Why did it pass? Why did we get that decision?
Sure. So the question is why, if this all sounds so good, what was the Supreme Court thinking, right? What did the Supreme Court decide and why in 2010 in the Citizens United decision? I've said before and I'll say again, it was a 5-4 decision, and these are very smart people, those five justices. They're honorable people. I think they made a mistake and they were wrong. And the millions of Americans who agree with me have failed to persuade them of that. But here's how they were thinking. There are two lines of cases, as Professor Chestek began to lay out, that have been kind of working their way together. One line of cases was increasingly dealing with situations where corporations were bringing cases that seemed to raise difficult issues about constitutional rights. And there's a bit of a puzzle, like if it's a corporation, how do you protect those rights? One just obvious example, New York Times versus Sullivan, a iconic First Amendment free press case. The New York Times is a corporation. Can the Supreme Court decide that First Amendment case about the press, even though that's a corporation? Well, yes, and they did, and for good reasons, and that's not controversial. But there is a cases where cigarette corporations wanted to advertise around schoolyards because their strategy was to addict, literally. I had some experience in the Attorney General's office during those tobacco cases back in the 90s. They wanted to target children to get them addicted to cigarettes, and they called them replacement smokers. So they're to replace the ones who died. So the marketing was targeted around middle schools, 13-year-old, 14-year-old, 15-year-olds, and using cartoons like Joe Camel, you might remember, some of you. Well, some states thought, that's not such a great idea, and created buffer zones. Massachusetts did this around schoolyards where it said no cigarette advertising. Well, that was struck down by the Supreme Court as a violation of corporate speech rights. And so that was a little further from the New York Times case. Now we're talking about cigarette corporations having rights to advertise to kids. So there was that line of cases that the court kept giving corporations more and more rights. Then there's another line of cases that came out of the 70s after Watergate and the reform of spending. And in a lot of ways, the Watergate scandal was a campaign finance scandal. A lot of corporate money, a lot of other money. And the Supreme Court started wrestling with, well, when is money like speech? Like, obviously, we wouldn't want laws that say no money can ever be spent on politics, or we wouldn't have any campaigns, right? You couldn't have a sign. Money has something to do with how we have politics and campaigns. So there were these cases that were incrementally moving further down the track of, well, money is like free speech. And so what the Supreme Court decided in Citizens United, the five justices essentially decided it's impossible to draw those lines. And basically, in their view, any time you try is like government censorship. That was the words Justice Kennedy used in the Citizens United decision, that if we do any kind of limits, it's the government censoring speech. Now, four justices, of course, disagreed and thought that's way too far, but they were in the minority. So the Supreme Court decision was basically the argument on the other side is, yeah, money is free speech. If corporations can be things like the New York Times and, the American Promise is a nonprofit corporation, right? and it's just too hard to figure out what's the difference between, you know, Exxon and New York Times, so we're not going to. That's basically, I'm sorry to be so long-winded, but I want to be fair to the question is, let's recognize the arguments on the other side. Again, I think they're wrong, but they're not by, you know, dishonorable or people who don't know what they're doing. Very smart justices who just elevated a narrow view of what the First Amendment is and said we basically can't ever limit any kind of money or we'll be violating the First Amendment.
If I could just add to that, I completely agree with everything Jeff said. This is the ultimate slippery slope argument. You take little incremental steps, and you fail to see the big picture and step back when necessary to see the bigger picture. We've been trapped by this metaphor of corporations or people. It has just built up so much momentum over time that it's hard to hold it back. So I think the amendment method is the only way really to stand up and say enough is enough. So other questions? Yeah.
Excuse my ignorance, but how much restrictions are on individual donors?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So there are individual limits on contributions directly to campaigns, and there still are today. So under federal law, it's $2,700. You cannot write a check for more than $2,700 to a federal candidate for office. And now, here's the problem, though. What the Supreme Court decided in the Citizens United decision is so-called independent spending. That's how the super PAC got born. So, all right, so you're limited to $2,700 if you get it right to a campaign. What if you want to give it to Americans for Apple Pie, who will then run all kinds of advertisements for that candidate or against that candidate? What the Supreme Court there said is no limit whatsoever. That's why billionaires literally have put $200 million, three billionaires alone in the 2016 election, put $200 billion into the election. The same $2,700 limit applied to them, they got $200 billion, just three of them, and these are both sides, Democrat, Republican, into the election with the new system under Citizens United. So that's the problem, is the limitations are basically pointless. But even under the limitations, I have to say, I don't want to call anybody out, but how many people are writing checks to politicians for $2,700, right? But that's where the politicians need to go in this system, because they need the money, especially if billionaires and corporations are putting billions in, and there's been close to $40 billion put into elections since the Citizens United decision. That puts even more pressure, and you ask any member of Congress when they're, you know, willing to say it, honestly, they spend much of their time calling wealthy people, talking to wealthy people. That's where their time is, because they need that $2,700 check. And that's why in lots of our states, the money funding our political system is actually coming from out of state. You know, the politicians are going to, well, Boston, LA, you know, Seattle, they're going around picking up those checks, and they're not able, even if they wanted to, as I think most of them do, spend time talking to their constituents. So, long-winded answer, but the basic fundamental question is, there are still some limits for now, those might go next, but for now, still limits that are fairly high. It's the unlimited thing that happened with the Citizens United decision. Just open the floodgates to unlimited spending by using these devices, super PACs, things like that.
So other question.
Those would be separate ballots.
Well, if we have the 28th Amendment, we will be able to limit no matter how you try to get it into the election. We the people will be able to say what's a reasonable limit, and we'll have limits whether it's contribution or independent spending, if it's intended to influence the outcome of an election. So one big battle for the 28th Amendment. Lots of hard work for different reform. Once we have the 28th Amendment, that's not the end of this. That's the beginning of a whole lot of new, better reforms.
Yeah.
So what's the 28th Amendment say?
Another great question. So there are last count, last Congress had 12 versions of the amendment introduced. And that's the other good news and the sort of untold story. Like, you know, Congress, which doesn't do much last session, right? They're sort of really divided and everything. They were busy introducing amendments. So something's going on. They're paying attention. So 12 different amendment bills, because everybody wanted their own, so they could say, yes, I'm in favor of this. But there's really some fundamental basics that are behind all of them. So I'll just, forgive me for just summarizing those. They're not direct quotes from anyone. But basically, they enable us to enact limits on contributions or spending in elections. And they enable us to do it at both federal level and the state level. The next section essentially says, and when we do that, we can distinguish between human beings and corporations. And so that one of them was introduced by Senator Tom Udall of New Mexico. That actually got 55 votes in the Senate in 2014. And we'll need 67 to get two-thirds of the Senate. But that's what it basically said. Section one, with states and federal government, we can limit contributions and spending in our elections. Section two is we can distinguish between human beings and corporations. So basically, we could have a limit of $500 for contributions from people and zero for corporations, unions, other entities that aren't people. And that's the others are variations on those themes, if you will. I'm sorry, but I just want to add, this is another, if you really want to get involved in this, American Promise is launching an 18-month program that's called Writing the 28th Amendment. And because we do need to get behind one amendment, not 12. So we have others on our advisory council, like Jim Nelson, a retired Supreme Court justice from the Montana Supreme Court. We have law professors. We have citizen leaders, as we call them, people who are in this work, who might have a particular interest, or people like Professor Chestek, lawyers and law professors, who want to participate in what should the amendment say, what's the best wording, what are some of the questions that will come up, and we're going to manage this process with all the way through until 18 months from now we'll come out with, not just we top down, like we have a national conference where everyone's invited, we've already had one, come to the next one, and we'll actually have a vote on what the amendment will say, and then bring that one to Congress to say this is the one we want. Okay?
I will take a few more questions, but before we do, I know we're getting, it's almost 1 o'clock. I just wanted to point out for those of you who need to leave right away, there's material on the back on a table outside, along with a copy of a book, copies of a book, Corporations Are Not People, that Jeff wrote. The book is for sale for $15 or more if you want to contribute more, because every dollar that the book generates goes back into this work. It's not making money for Jeff, it's making money for this movement, so we can have a way to get this movement moving forward. So if you want to buy the book, please do so. So Shelby, question.
Just really quick, I wanted to, this is sort of a question slash plug for, there's multiple groups that are working on this issue. There's Move to Amend, there's American Promise, and I'm with a group called Wolfpack. It's wolf-pack.com, and it's a super PAC to end all super PACs. And
literally.
Literally, yeah.
And, literally end them.
Absolutely. And so it's not, we're not, as groups, we're all kind of working together around the nation to get this 28th Amendment. Wolfpack in particular, we're also looking at the Article 5 Limited Amendments Convention. As a way of getting this pushed forward, rather than just asking Congress to fix itself, we're pushing for two-thirds of the states to call for a convention limited to this issue only. We have five states that have already resolved to call for this limited amendments convention. It's California, Illinois, Rhode Island, New Jersey, and Vermont. And so I just wanted to plug that for everybody to let you know that I'm a local organizer for this other national organization, and I think that, you know, I totally support American Promise, I support Move to Amend, and I encourage you to support multiple groups, because I think if we push for all of these different things, both ways of amending the Constitution, we're going to have more teeth, and really calling a limited amendments convention has never been called, but it has put enough pressure on Congress to pass an amendment themselves. And one example of that was the 17th Amendment, direct election of senators. We used to not be able to directly elect our senators, and that was also dealing with the issue of corruption, just as money in politics is. So if anybody's interested in that, I have more information here. You can go to wolf-pack.com to see some more stuff. I'm organizing volunteers, and I'm here in the Laramie community. So if you're interested in that, thank you.
Just to follow up on that, if, as we think is a likely outcome, the legislature does not go for this. The bill that's going to go in the legislature actually calls for Congress to do this, does not call for a constitutional convention, because the people I've been talking to the legislators didn't want to go that route with this resolution. If it fails, and we do a citizens initiative, we are no longer bound by that restriction. So the petition that we'll send around this summer, if we have to, we'll probably do both things. We'll probably call for Congress to do it, and failing that, to have a constitutional convention. So we're going to try either. It's like you're locked out of your house, and you need to find a way that's to go in. So you try all the possible doors until one works, and then you're in, right? So we're going to try all these possible routes. Other questions? Yes, right here.
I recall, I think it was Justice Kennedy who, when questioned about the decision, posing that the dark money could end up going where it has, dismissed that as a likelihood. Has he revisited that?
Yeah, so the question is, has Justice Kennedy or the majority of the court re-examined some of their assumptions, including the, you know, money would be disclosed, there wouldn't be foreign money in our elections. No, they haven't revisited that, and they really need to. Citizens United, the decision is filled with assumptions that turned out to be wrong. And, you know, much as I respect the Supreme Court, and I do, they're not actually very in touch with how politics actually works. Sandra Day O'Connor was the last one on the Supreme Court who had actually ever run for anything. She'd been a state legislator in Arizona. And she was strongly in favor of limits and corporations not having these same rights, as was Justice Rehnquist, another conservative from Arizona. We now have a Supreme Court that hasn't had that kind of experience. So they made all kinds of assumptions like, oh, don't worry, the money will be disclosed. And don't worry about corporations. We can have what they called corporate democracy. So the shareholders can decide whether they, so all you who own all your shares in those corporations, don't worry, you can vote on that. So they haven't examined those assumptions. I'm not sure they will. They've had chances to, and they haven't. They've only gone further down, doubled down on it. So I think there's a question up here, too.
One last question over here?
Yeah.
Under Citizens United, unions are covered as well as corporations. There have been plenty of union bosses who have been prosecuted and sent to jail. What is the likelihood outside of the federal Justice Department to have criminal corruption charges brought up against corporate heads of banks, people like that, who have gone without being held accountable?
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, the question of corruption, as you point out, can be in a union, it can be in a corporation, wherever there's concentrated power, concentrated money. There can be corruption, and I think the question has is one that a lot of Americans are asking: is when does the CEO get prosecuted when there's corruption in a corporation? And the answer is not often. You know, whether it was the 2008 financial crash or many other criminal cases, and I don't say criminal lightly. Corporations convicted of crimes, high. Leadership in those corporations has not gone to jail. There is one exception recently. There may be another one coming with the Volkswagen fraud that happened. They're starting to look at executives. But the most dramatic corporate misconduct in memory for many people was the Massey coal mine explosion in West Virginia, killed 29 men in that mine. And it turned out that the reason that explosion happened, not only was corporate misconduct ignoring safety regulations, things like that, it turned out, and this is according to an independent commission appointed by the governor of West Virginia who looked at the causes, they linked it directly to the problem we're talking about today. They linked it to the inability of the West Virginia government, the state officials, whose responsibility was to protect those miners, not being able to do their jobs because of the power of that corporation over the political system in West Virginia. And so 29 men died as a result. There was a case brought against the CEO. Now this CEO is a guy named Don Blankenship. He was fired. Actually, no, that's not accurate. He wasn't fired. After the explosion happened, Massey merged with an even bigger coal corporation called Alpha. And so they only needed one CEO. Don Blankenship retired with $86 million he was paid to retire. But he was prosecuted, and he was convicted as being part of the conspiracy that led to those 29 men dead. I believe his sentence was something like 18 months. So that was a rare example of the U.S. attorney in West Virginia, the federal government, actually prosecuting a CEO, but it took 29 dead men to do it. And I think, you know, it's part of the problem, not just that, again, like Professor Chestek said, it's not that corporations are evil, or that it's that the, if we don't have the checks and balances that our system depends on, we get wild imbalances of power and people able to just have the fates of human beings in their hands with horrible consequences if we're not able to have that balance restored again. So I think when we get this problem solved, we'll have not only better performing corporations and more jobs and a better business environment, but we'll have better judgment about when it's possible to hold, have justice when things go wrong. So thank you for the question. Thank you for everybody being here today. We're doing this again tonight, maybe a little less legally, since we won't be in the law school, at the library, the town library, at 7 p.m. So go on out, come back with three or four people, and we'll talk more about how we can keep this movement going all over the state.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.